Well, compared to me. But hi, everyone. Welcome to Life Bulb Live. Karn and I are just talking about our different skin colors, our skin tones. And next to, I look darker than she looks. Well, I guess we're like a nice little Oreo cookie here. I don't like Oreo
Thank
cookies,
you.
but whatever. Anyways, I'm actually really excited to have this talk today because living with multiple chronic illnesses is difficult. Living with one is difficult, but living with multiple is stressful and it's hard, especially around people who don't have multiple illnesses. So we have one of our ambassadors on today, which I'm super excited to have with us. And her name is Rennie, and she is the yoga extraordinaire. So I'm super glad to have you here.
Hello, thank you for having me.
So
I'm
nice
so
to see you.
happy to be here as my first live event as an ambassador. I'm super excited.
We are honored to
So.
have you in as an ambassador. We had a great meeting last or the other day with our ambassadors, and Rennie did some amazing breathing and stretching for us while we're at our desk, which is so important. It was so funny to see everyone say, "I needed that, I needed that, I needed that." And that is part of living with a chronic illness, is taking even 10 minutes of your out of your day to kind of help yourself balance a little bit more. So, Rennie, could you just tell us a little bit about your story?
Yeah, sure. So, I was diagnosed with MS in 2003. It's likely I've been living with it. I can look back, with hindsight and say that I've been living with it since probably 1991, 92. And it was pretty clear by the neurologist who diagnosed me when he saw the MRI. He was like, "You have had this a very long time." Just silly things we don't pay attention to, and that's one big thing. When I mean, you don't think about it when you're young, and you think you're healthy, but little things that you don't realize can be symptoms are symptoms. And with hindsight, I know that for sure that it was 91, 92-ish where I started having symptoms of MS. And like, before I even go any further, I just want to say about the meeting with the ambassadors. I got so much feedback from other ambassadors that absolutely love the stretching and the breathing. So
I
I was
love it.
so happy to be able to give them a little tool to help de-stress, during certain times of the day. So,
Yeah, I loved it. It was great. I'm going to interject for a second and just say to you, MS is hard because there are so many symptoms and everybody's symptoms come out in a different way. And I agree with you. I knew, looking back in retrospect, I can tell when I was exhibiting signs, and I thought it was, oh, my back hurts because I was exercising too much, or my legs felt dead because I did legs that day. But it really wasn't. It was all
The
signs.
clumsiness was my big thing. The clumsiness and the fatigue. Like, I used to walk into things. I still do. I mean,
I
I'm
do
like a
too.
pinball in this house. I bounce off the walls. It's just how I roll. Like, my sister always tells me, be careful when you're not standing on your head, because that's usually when I'm most balanced, is when I'm doing my inversions. But
That is
I
hilarious.
seriously do it and get knocked off balance so easily on my feet. And that was like the first real thing that I can remember is just being super clumsy. Super clumsy. Like, I see the wall. I know that I'm walking. Why can't I go straight instead of walking into the wall? So MS, like, I'm wearing an MS shirt. You can't really see it, but because it's like the umbrella. It's like the first one of my chronic illnesses, the one I think is the biggest one, the one that most people or the least amount of people really understand. And the symptoms are so innocuous sometimes that, because they can't see them, I don't use a walker or a wheelchair. If I'm going to a crowded place, I'll use a cane so that it's just an outward symbol for people to see that, like, to keep their distance. Like, if I'll go and now I haven't been to New York City since pre-pandemic, but that's one example of when I would use my cane because it's crowded. There's so many people, and I will go into full-on panic attack in a crowd because I feel very off balance, and I have a very wide-based gait as like a coping mechanism for walking. And so I'm scared that I'm going to fall. And the last thing, like the most embarrassing thing that can happen is when I fall in front of people, because I pop right up and then I go, I look around, and it doesn't matter what time of the day it is. I mean, I remember I fell one time, it was 6 o'clock in the morning, and I was leaving my house, to go to work. And of course I fell and I popped up and I looked around to see who saw. Like, who cares at 6 in the morning?
This is important right now, because isn't it funny how you're embarrassed and you can't help that? Like, that's part of your chronic illness, is you can't help your balancement. Yet when we fall, and I've had exactly what you described happen. I was in a crowded room. It was right when I was first diagnosed with MS and my hands were not working. Like, I had to really think that there was something in my hand. Otherwise I would just drop it. My hand would just stop. My brain wasn't getting to my hand. And I dropped a wine glass in this crowded room and it smashed and everyone looked at me and I was like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Like, I was mortified, but why? First of all, I was in a room with a bunch of chronic people with chronic illness. So I shouldn't have been mortified, but I was embarrassed by that.
I know, it's really something really hard to accept. And like, when I walk into a wedding and I see a buffet set up, I'm like, oh no, I have to walk with a plate. And now, like, you know, my husband will hold my plate and we'll go down like once for me and put my plate down and then he'll go and get his, you know.
Right.
But I mean, it's just nobody thinks about these things and how hard they are. You know, it seems so simple, but it's really not when you're living with it every single day. And then you add multiple chronic illnesses on top. But, you know.
So let's go through your repertoire. You got MS. What else you got in that pocket of yours?
So MS. I'm a breast cancer survivor. And I'm a diabetic, type 2 diabetic. This is my newest. And I also have a fused spine. That doesn't have anything to do with chronic illness, although I deal with the after effects every day because, you know, once you have a back problem, I always say that you're always going to have a back problem.
Right.
And you know, there is a very clear possibility that I'll need future surgeries, because when you fuse parts of the spine, then the parts above and below get more pressure than they should.
That happened to me, Rennie. I fused C4, C5, and 2 years later I had to fuse C5, C6.
Right. And typically the ones above it that are the ones that need to be fused. So I'm really hoping it doesn't come to that. I don't want to go through that again. But really, it's just a little bump compared to a lifelong diagnosis of MS and diabetes. And like, I think we started to talk about having this live because we talked about, like, I was joking about how I say that I swim in a shallow gene pool. When I first talked to Karen, and she was like she liked that I was like very, you know, I was upbeat about it, because you know what, like, everybody has their own journey and mine is what it is. And it doesn't devalue me as a human being. In fact, it makes me stronger. And I have never been the one to say, why me? Like, I'm always like, why not? Why not me? What's different from me from anybody else? Like, anybody could have it. And, you know, when you have MS and you're suppressing your immune system for so many years, then like my official diagnosis is 18 years, but living longer. So for at least 18 years, I've been suppressing my immune system. So of course I'm going to be opened up to get other things. In my book, like, no doctor will tell me that, but in my mind, when I think about it, okay, so I'm suppressing those fighters, the B cells and the T cells, who's going to fight the battle on the front line, you know? So I always tell people, because I also run an MS and exercise group on Facebook. We have about 4,100 members now.
That's incredible.
And I tell people, just move. It doesn't, I've replaced the word exercise with movement all the time. And I just say, just move. That's all. Just move your body as much as you can. If you can only move your arms, then just move your arms. Do what you can do, because once you stop moving, it is done.
Yeah, I remember you and I spoke about that. And I think that was one of my the most impressive things that you're doing. I mean, you're doing many good things, but this just move, I think, is it's really, really cool, because it's just relative to the person. You know, not everyone needs to be a marathon runner. Really, no one should be a marathon runner. It's terrible for your body.
Yeah, it is.
But
you want to walk when you're old.
Yeah. But just moving so that you don't injure yourself. Because most sports is, you know, for me, I'm very bad at that, because when I do something, I do it to the extreme. I'm very bad at moderating or doing things so that it doesn't push me to the limits. And, you know, sports is, it really makes you push your body. And if you're just moving, but in doing it in a healthy way, it is good for everyone.
And
it's just hard, I guess. I mean, going back to your point of why you would be embarrassed when you fell or when you fall. I mean, literally yesterday I walked into a glass wall because I didn't see it. You know, poor vision because of diabetes and especially contrast vision is very difficult for me when there's a light and, you know, I just don't see it. And it happens. And I've walked in so numerous glass walls and sometimes they fall. Sometimes I just get a big, hematoma or, you know, and every time I do it, I smile, right? Because I'm not going to admit that it hurts and I'm embarrassed.
Right.
You know, I just smile.
Right.
It's of course it's not fun to be different. You know, no one wants to be different in a negative way. We all want to be different in a good way. We want to stand
right.
out. We want to be more beautiful, more successful, more, you know, whatever is the more. But very few people say, I want to be less balanced, see less well, and you know, look worse. It is very hard. I listened to the two of you saying, you know, we shouldn't be embarrassed, but it's human to want to be at least as good as everyone else, if not better. And I just wonder how we, I think, especially Emery, when you were saying it was in a group of many people who all have issues, should be very much accommodating. And it should be pretty, it's different when you're in a group of Navy SEALs or, you know, superheroes. But so I find that to be a hard one to get to coach. How do you tell a young person that it's okay to be less than, you know, it's okay to live your life less than everyone else?
I think that the answer is that they have to find where their strengths lie.
You have to find
other things. They can be less than in one way, but they find, you know, their true calling. Like, I didn't intend to retire from teaching when I was just 42 years old and MS didn't want me to go back to the classroom.
Yep.
So I had to, and my whole family, believe me, I was 100% invested in being a teacher. That was my identity. I didn't know who I was. I went out of work and I was lost. I went into a very deep depression and I wasn't very mobile at the time. I was moving because I know that you have to keep moving. But also with MS, like, there's this fine line that we walk between exercising, between working and working too hard, because we can overheat. I have an overheating issue. Most people who have MS have sort of thermoregulation issues where they can't regulate their body temperature. And I get it at the extreme heat level, but it doesn't have to be extreme to other people. It's to me.
Right.
And so, like, my air conditioning is on 64. That's where we keep our house year round. And my poor husband walks around in a hoodie with the hood up. But he knows that this is, and look, I'm in short sleeves and shorts. He knows this is what I need. And so we do that. So you have to find where your spot is. And it's the same with finding where your identity is. Like, I don't have to be the best.
That's why it's so hard when you're not yet a full person. When you're in your late teens or when you're in your early 20s and you're really searching for who you are going to become as an adult, with all the insecurities that you have as a growing individual, hormones and, you know, comparing yourself, it's really hard. So I think that what we can do as, you know, women who are older, in not saying that in a negative way, but at least older than teenagers and early 20s, is to show that it's okay, and we can be great at some things, maybe not great at everything. And the whole, I think, idea that we can do everything and we can be so good at everything, I think is flawed, because no one can be good at everything. And, you know, it goes back to the very healthy, you know, suburban mom who thinks that she can be great at everything.
Right.
And I'm talking about someone who has no disease. I mean, they seem to put pressure on themselves, or suburban or urban or rural, whatever. The mother is always trying to do everything so well And I guess you got to say, you can't do it all. It's not possible. And I think the sooner we realize that, the better. And there's something about American culture that we're supposed to be winners, you know, in everything. not some people are not meant to run fast, right? They're right. Just not that good. So why are right. we competing all the time?
You just described me as a mother. I really felt like I had to make all the baby food. I couldn't buy a jar of baby food. Everything had to be homemade. And I did. I have four kids for the first 3 and a half, because after a while with Julian, it broke me down mentally. You exactly described what broke me down is I couldn't be this, I used to call it a DIY Pinterest mom. That was not who I am. I'm not that mom. I mean, I'm still a good mom because even though I didn't make homemade baby food, I don't need to make homemade baby food. My kids can eat, whatever. But there is a mentality, and I'm not really judging suburban from urban, but in suburbia, 100% to be that epitome of a mother. And then being diagnosed with cancer was one thing. I had a breakdown the year before my cancer diagnosis, but cancer was one thing because it was like acceptable being sick with cancer because, you can see that. But when I got MS, those moms had no clue what I was going through. None. And that was hard. But you just opened my eyes to something because you said, one second, Rennie, you said you don't have to be good at everything. And that's the problem is we do think we have to be good at everything and we don't. I can't run fast. I'm slow at running. I can't, I can't do whatever. I can't swim laps in the pool.
I hate art. I cannot do an art project. And, when my daughter comes home and says, when her teacher tells us to draw on stones and, make art projects, I just can't do it. I really hate it. And it's just, I got to delegate. That's not what I do well. Or I do it and it's just, she will be assessed as someone who didn't do a good project. But, we got to realize we have to divide and conquer to a certain extent and also come together. But, divide
and, this is
divide,
part
conquer,
of
and then come together.
That younger generation, those teens, younger 20s who are being diagnosed with illnesses, that's part of their problem too. This is 100% true because they're in this world where it's instant gratification. They have to do everything right. Everything has to be picture perfect. And then you're diagnosed with MS, IBD, diabetes, whatever it is. And it alters your life so immensely. And you're not that pretty picture on Instagram anymore. That is really hard for kids. However, we can show them that you can live this lifestyle in your own way. And it can still be a beautiful picture.
Yeah. And I think that the other thing that we do and that we shouldn't is we compare ourselves to other people. And we can't even, we shouldn't even be comparing ourselves to ourselves from yesterday because every single day is different. So you just have to be open to who you are and what's going to happen and kind of roll with the punches. Now, this is really hard for me. I've been a planner my whole life.
Me too.
My life was planned out. And this, MS certainly did not fit with that whole part of me. And I was also a perfectionist. I have gotten a lot better since I stopped working. And I've just been doing a lot of work. I've been in therapy, just working on myself. And I've been meditating longer than I've been practicing yoga. And meditation is such an amazing tool. And if it weren't for yoga and meditation, I don't think that I would be a functional human being at this point.
About comparing, this is actually a perfect example. You and I, we both have MS. We both have breast cancer. We couldn't be two physically diverse people. I can't stand the way you do your yoga poses. There's no way I could do any of that. That doesn't make us worse or better, but we have very similar diagnoses, but we're not the same. It's just not, any chronic illness is not linear. It just isn't.
Right.
It's a big ball of tangled yarn.
I remember I had a, during the last few years that I was teaching, we had a student who was diagnosed with MS and she had a very severe onset. And they did not know what was wrong with her. They thought maybe she had a stroke. It was very bad. And she has a very severe case. She's African-American. Somehow they end up getting hit so hard with MS.
They do. You're right.
And her goal, her only goal was to wear high heels to the prom. That was her goal. That's what she went to rehab for. That's what she worked on. And, you know, I think that even still, I worry, I still do see her on occasion. But, you know, she has since had children. And, you know, I think that she is in a little bit of a denial. Like, she doesn't really know a lot about MS. Mm-hmm. She didn't take the time to learn. I don't know if it's because she's from a very urban sort of, an urban with inner city tendencies, I would say, area. And so I don't think that she's learned enough to be comfortable with moving forward. And I don't think she has any idea what the future could hold, which is maybe better, but I like to be prepared and I like to know, and I like to know what I can do. I eat healthy. I move my body. You know, I exercise, I do yoga, I meditate, I see a therapist. Like, all these things are so important in the grand scheme of a happy life.
You're talking about self-resilience, though. And that's a really hard, I use self-resilience instead of self-care now, because I feel like self-care is still considered selfish. When we talk about, you know, oh, I'm going to get a massage, so I need to self-care, people are like, oh, you just want to go get a massage. I'm like, no, actually, I physically need to get a massage. Like, I have to. But if I say I'm being self-resilient, because I'm trying to preserve myself futuristically, I don't know what 10 years is going to bring, 5 years or 2 weeks. Yesterday, I had the worst MS flare I've had in a long time. I could not walk. I could not get my brain to get to my feet to tell me to take a step and to take a step. It was, I had drag foot. It was terrible. I had to be self-resilient and lay down. I had no choice. But it's really hard when you are uneducated in that world. And I think it's not just about your culture. Some illnesses aren't, there's no, like, there's barely anything out there, really. Like, you don't see billboards. You don't see this. You know, I look at transplant. I've learned so much from LifePulp in the transplant community and everything that they go through. I'm inundated in chronic illness. I've never seen anything. I've never been educated about that. So it is more about sharing these stories. We've got to share our stories. Because if we don't, it's really the only way for people to hear what's going on. I don't need a pamphlet to tell me about MS. Yeah.
And I think it's important. It's really important. I mean, everyone talks about diversity, but it is important. It is important to share stories from different mm-hmm. perspectives. Because, you know, when we look at a specific disease, I mean, I also have diabetes, but type 1. But, you know, I developed diabetes at a younger age than you did. And it's different when you're in a setting. In a different setting. So that's why we need the diversity. We need the different socioeconomic, the different educational. We need to put that public health eye on as well, because if we don't put the person in their natural environment, then we can yoga as much as we want. But, you know, that person may not be set up to do it. And, right. and certain environments for, you know, a man, maybe in the Nordic countries where I'm from, to be self-caring, I mean, it would be looked upon as a terrible misuse of his time, and not, and so we need to put that perspective on and really showcase those stories as well. And unfortunately, you know, we did talk about social media before this. And social media often shows the success stories. Mm-hmm. You know, we see people who are looking great. You know, they may have a chronic disease, and we see a before and an after picture. We see they did look bad at some point, but now they mm-hmm. look great and they're doing these fantastic things and they're okay with it. It's but it is hard. I mean, I went through some tough times, but I didn't share, you know, with the public when I went through it. I'm not that open, but you know, I'm open about it afterwards, because the sharing during the tough times is, I think, really difficult. And it can be probably cathartic, and it can be very good psychologically to do it, to get that community to support you. And that's what we need to encourage, you know, so people actually see the realness of the multiple diseases. Because, again, if you have MS, but you also had a cancer, which means that you've been on treatment, that affects your immune system, may have been a trigger to the MS, by the way. And you know, you probably would have developed MS anyway, but maybe, you know, it was triggering it. And then there's diabetes that, you know, was triggered by maybe some of the drugs that you were taking because you were on steroids. And, you know, so there's so many things that are impacting the overall disease. The overall, not the disease, but the overall condition that the person is going through. So you have to think about the different diseases from a medical perspective, think about it from a psychological perspective, and then think about the public health and the systems effect, and then it becomes incredibly complicated. So who are we to judge, you know, what people feel? So that's why we need the stories. We need the stories from everyone. We need to encourage people to share.
Yeah, like every time I join one of these little yoga things on Instagram, I start off and I tell right off, my first post always says, I'm a bigger bodied yogi who deals with multiple chronic illnesses. And if I can step on a mat, you can too. And it doesn't have to look like my yoga. My yoga didn't look like my yoga even a year ago. It's a practice. And my first yoga class, I hated it. I was like, ugh, I am never doing that again. Meanwhile, fast forward like 6 years and I'm a yoga teacher with 400 hours of instruction. But it was only because I wanted to be able to share with other people that if they just move, they will feel such a difference. And I know that some of my, I have a lot of friends with MS, and during the pandemic, I was doing yoga 3 times a day because I didn't know what the heck to do with myself. And they were not moving, and they are still not moving. And it's going to be hard for them to move. Now.
Once you get out of that routine, it is hard to get back into it.
Yeah. For sure. So I try to keep it up. And if I have an off day, I have an off day. That's the other thing that I have learned to do, is to stop beating myself up when I can't do something one day. Like if I wake up and I am like having a dizzy day, I know it's not smart of me to exercise. I know that. And I don't beat myself up about it, because I love that you say self-resilience, because that's such a great alternative to self-care, because I think you're right. Self-care has like a primping, like I'm going to pamper
myself. I
feel
like it has a stigma around it. I don't know why.
Yeah, it's about, because it comes across as pampering, and what we're and doing is trying to live. Yeah. So
there's one thing, Karin, and Rennie, I think that we're saying here, and I think it's really important. Karin, you said that you didn't, when you were going through things, you didn't really share. You were more, you know, you're more of a private person. I think it's really, it's hard to share with people that you are even friends with or close with. Like, it's hard to share those really private moments with yourself, about yourself. It's hard because they're not sharing. So you kind of have this weird wall. But then you join these communities like LifeBulb, where you have all these people sharing their chronic illness story. I've never met Rennie in my life. I hope someday I do, so I can give her a big hug, because she feels like a friend of mine, because through LifeBulb, I've gotten to know her, not just as an ambassador, but as a human being. And I've heard her story. Same with Daniel and Ella and all the other ambassadors we have, because we're listening to their stories, but we don't know each other. It's really easier to share socially with a network of people like this, because
you know
you're safe. And that's,
and
I think,
we're all
really
like
important.
Connecting with each other, which is amazing, because I really think that this group of people, they're, every single one of them is 100% amazing in their own way. And I just love how supportive the community is. Like, we like each other's stuff. We comment, we send each other messages. It's a really cool thing. And and to know that we are also influencing the public to look at a more patient-centered sort of perspective.
Well, that to me is the next step. That's the next step, because right now I think we as individuals do that. You are doing it. All our ambassadors are doing it. But coming together as a group and saying, okay, this is our goal. You know, this is what, that to me is the next step. As we build our community and as we get tighter and as we understand the commonalities between the different diseases and the different, you know, people characteristics, and we can say our goal is really, you know, 1, 2, 3, and then we can go for it, because otherwise we are not organized enough, right? Because for us to accomplish something on the bigger scale, we got to set up priorities. And I think that would be interesting. Anne Marie, as you grow, you know, our group of ambassadors, and the ambassadors become friendlier and come together, and we have done some, you know, hopefully live in-person events, and everyone can actually touch each other. You know, we should say, this is our goal for this year. This is our goal for the next 3 years. And make real policy changes. That's really the goal, you know, in my view, long term.
Yeah.
I think a beautiful goal is a nice life bulb conference with all these beautiful ambassadors.
That's the first step. Yep.
Yeah.
That's going to be the first step.
And then hopefully we leave this seed planted for the next generation to really take the ball and run with it and know exactly how to advocate for themselves, to make their experience more patient friendly, to seek out the right medical professionals. I just went through a big thing because I left my MS specialist of 17 years, all but one of my diagnosed years. And it was like a breakup. And I really had to prepare for it, like to make sure I didn't want to cry, you know, like there's so many emotions wrapped up into this, you know, when you think about like this person has 17 years of my history.
Right.
You know, and I'm
and those
leaving.
Are things that we can leave for the younger generation to understand that, you know, it's hard to do something like that, but sometimes you have to, and it's okay.
Yeah. And you know, that's kind of like my legacy as a teacher, because I left early, but you know, I was very open about my MS diagnosis. I felt like I had the, it was my responsibility to educate people because nobody knew what the heck it was. And so it was huge. And so I have a lot of my former students that have chronic illnesses that were still in touch, and they reach out to me. And if they find somebody, you know, they meet somebody that has MS, they'll give them my information. You know, I took a perfect stranger to her independent medical exam because she was afraid, and I helped her fill out her paperwork for SSDI. And she was referred to me by somebody I worked with, and now she's a friend. So these are the things that are my legacy.
I think how you said it is the perfect way to wrap this up is it's your responsibility to educate. And I have to say that is powerful and so amazing, but it's not for everybody. What you can do, if it's not your legacy to educate people, is share somebody's story. It takes that little button to share on Facebook, Instagram, wherever. Share someone else's story. If it's not something you want to share personally, share somebody else's, because you never know who you're gonna touch. So, Rennie, thank you so much for being a Life Bulb ambassador, for being so amazing, and for taking time out today and chatting with us, because I think this was a really great conversation.
Yeah, so, thank you so much.
And one more thing I want to say is, no matter what you do, just do it with a smile on your face. I've always been an optimist. And smiling just makes it so much easier. And there's a book that I read, and the author says, fake it till you make it. So start smiling.
Start smiling.
You're going to end up feeling it.
Yeah. There you go. Thank you so much.